Tonight, the Jefferson Literary and Debating Society, now in its 182nd year of perpetual existence, is both pleased and proud to present the seventh speaker in its weekly speaker series for the spring semester of 2012, Dr. Masumi Farah. Dr. Farah will present a speech entitled Alexander the Great in the Persian World. Masumi Farah received her BA in Art History from Wellesley College and went on to receive her PhD in Islamic Art History from Harvard University. She served on the editorial board of Ars Orientalis, Mubarnas, and the Journal for Persianate Studies. She also served as President of Historians of Islamic Art on the Harvard Divinity School Leadership Council and as an institutional trustee at the American Institute for Iranian Studies. Dr. Farah joined the Freer Gallery of Art and the Arthur M. Sackler Gallery in 1995 as Associate Curator of Islamic Art. In 2004, she was appointed Chief Curator and Curator of Islamic Art. She is a specialist in the arts of the both from 16th and 17th century Iran. Farah has curated numerous exhibitions on the arts of the Islamic world at the Freer and Sackler, including Art of the Persian Courts, Fountains of Light, the new Hamid Said collection of metalwork, Style and Status, Imperial Costumes from Ottoman Turkey, Tsars in the East, Gift from Turkey and Iran in Moscow Kremlin, Fulnama, the Book of Omens, and most recently, Feast Your Eyes, The Taste for Luxury in Ancient Iran. She has written extensively on 17th century Persian painting, including Slaves of the Shah, New Elites in Safavid Iran, and Fulnama, the Book of Omens. Jefferson Society is indeed honored to host such a distinguished individual. Please stand and join me in welcoming Dr. Masumi.
He was born in 356 BCE in Pella, the ancient capital. Polybius, the princes of neighboring Epirus. When he reached the age of 13, his father actually got the philosopher Aristotle to be his personal tutor. During the next 3 years, Aristotle gave Alexander a training in rhetoric, literature, and stimulated his interest in science, which remained really important throughout Alexander's life. In 336 BC, Philip II was assassinated, and Alexander succeeded his father to the throne of Macedonia. He inherited a strong kingdom, an experienced army, and what better than go to war? So in 334, Alexander invaded the Persian ruled Asia Minor. Sorry, it's difficult to see, but you sort of get the vague outline. He was born right where my finger is, and then sort of moved eastward towards Iran. He began a series of campaigns that lasted over 10 years. He confronted the Achaemenid ruler, Darius II, three times, one in the Battle of Issus, and then in the famous Battle of Gaugamela, and this is the mosaic, it's a later one, where you see, it's a Roman one, where you see Alexander there, and poor Darius, it's hard to see on this slide, but looking very scared. In the year 331, the Macedonian troops penetrated deeper into the heartland of the Persian Empire and approached Persepolis, the political and religious seat of the empire. Now, according to the Greek sources, when Alexander finally occupied the site, he looted the treasury, vandalized the audience hall, and before leaving, perhaps accidentally or on purpose, burned down his magnificent palace. Now, there's a lot of debate whether it was done on purpose or accidentally, whether Alexander was drunk or not drunk. But several Greek and Roman sources also maintain that the idea of burning the palace was instigated by a woman called Pais, a female companion of one of Alexander's commanders. I love it because it's always a woman's fault. We don't know, but I just thought I should mention it. One of the reasons that this palace actually burned down was that there was a lot of cedar, and when it was excavated at the end of the 19th century, there were 3 or 4 feet of burned cedar that they found. So that's why it caught fire. And the other thing is there really were no doors. There were just curtains hanging from these columns. So those also quickly caught fire, and there are some, again, good descriptions of that. Allegedly, Alexander also destroyed texts relating to Zoroastrianism, which was the main religion of the Achaemenids, as well as their fire temples, probably in response to the Zoroastrian priest's resistance to his military advances. Leaving behind in 330 BC, the smoking ruins of Persepolis in pursuit of Darius, the Achaemenid king, he fled in advance of Alexander's approach. Alexander found the Persian king dying alone from wounds inflicted by his own men. He ensured that Darius was given a royal burial, punished his murderers, and took control of the Persian Empire. Alexander's domain now stretched from the Adriatic Sea to the Indus River. Following his desire to reach the ends of the world and the great outer sea, quote, this is again from one of the Greek sources, he invaded India in 326, but was eventually forced to turn back by the near mutiny of his troops. Alexander succumbed to fever in Babylon in 323, and some claim that he was poisoned because he was planning another campaign to invade Arabia and his troops just had enough. But more recently, it has been claimed that he actually died from the West Nile fever. Again, it's because nobody really knows where Alexander is buried. It's difficult to determine how he died. Upon his death, Iran suffered a period of turmoil and was torn apart. Subsequently, it was ruled by two dynasties, which witnessed the introduction of Greek artistic traditions into Persian art. Now, Alexander kindly mentioned my last exhibition, Feast of the Eyes, and I hope you can come to Washington to come and see it, because there are a number of really outstanding examples of metalwork that show this great influence on Persian art. Now, in the year 224, and I'm, you know, these are all sort of dates, but there isn't going to be a test at the end, but this one is important. In the year 224, Ardashir defeated the last Greek dynasty that ruled Iran and established another Iranian dynasty called the Sasanian dynasty, and basically claimed to be the legitimate successor of the Achaemenid. So in many ways, this sort of the Greek interlude, according to the historical sources, it was an interlude. Alexander was a usurper, and when the Sasanians came to power, it was really sort of a direct connection back to the Persian rulers, the Achaemenids. Now, not surprising, the image of Alexander in ancient Persian literature, which were religious and liturgical, was far from favorable. He, in one source, mentions that, and I quote, "Alexander burned 12,000 oxen hides from our religion and Persepolis. Part of the religion has remained in people's memories, but they remember only the stories and the legends, and they do not know the laws. May he be avenged." In another source, the people of Iran were promised that the supreme deity of ancient Iran, Ormazd, will redress Alexander's conquest and will not leave the evildoer alone. Like other usurpers, he will be completely destroyed and wiped off the earth in spite of his power. So, this is the view of Alexander in ancient Iran. Now, as suggested in the beginning, this image of Alexander as conqueror and destroyer was interrupted the succession of legitimate Persian sovereigns undergoes a dramatic transformation after the Arabs conquered Iran in 651. I'm just showing you a coin with the image of Alexander. To the new Muslim rulers, the military accomplishments of Alexander, who controlled the largest empire known at the time, naturally inspired awe and admiration. In fact, during his lifetime, Alexander actively encouraged the creation of a personal myth by emulating some of his legendary predecessors, such as Hercules and Dionysus, and by visiting the Oracle of Amman at Sivas in Egypt, where he allegedly heard that he was the son of God, identified by the Greeks as Zeus. Hence, he is often depicted with two horns as attributions of Zeus, and you see it often actually on coins of the period. Now, these fantastic stories are contained in the so-called Alexander Romances, or the Pseudo-Palestinians, a narrative of the Greek conquest life, including many legendary events and fabulous adventures, which was composed between 200 and 300 BC. And I'm showing you an image, actually it's from a French manuscript, medieval manuscript, of an Alexander romance. And I love this image because Alexander is in a glass submarine. And that was one of his great, there are many sort of wonder stories. One of it, especially in some Western manuscripts, I'm sitting in that glass, sort of looks like a beer keg, but it's supposed to be a submarine. The name of Pseudo-Palestine is derived from a false attribution to Aristotle's nephew, Palestinianus, who accompanied Alexander's expedition as his official historian. There are more than 80 renditions of Alexander's romances in some 24 languages, including Syriac, became the basis for later Persian and Arabic versions. They all vary slightly, but they all present Alexander sort of larger than life, and sort of the historical Alexander sort of completely glossed over. Now, the earliest Persian text to include an elaborate section on Alexander is the Shahnameh, or Book of Kings, completed in the year 1010 by the the Sultan, and the Sultan was unimpressed and really gave him a very small, sort of meager fee. And Ferdowsi was so upset that he shared it with a bath attendant and a beer seller before going back to his home. He just thought, ah, this is just not worth it. And 10 years later, the Sultan sort of thought about it again and figured, now Ferdowsi really deserves to be rewarded. He sends a caravan to his town, but as soon as the caravan enters the city, another caravan is coming out and it's carrying the coffin of Ferdowsi. So Ferdowsi was never acknowledged for this amazing feat that he had that he had accomplished during his lifetime. But he knew, because he predicts at the end of the Shahnameh that his work will outlive all the sultans and kings of the world. And I'm just going to read it to you. This is how he ends his great epic. I've reached the end of this great history, and all the land will fill with talk of me. I shall not die. These seeds of sown will save my name and reputation from the grave. And men of sense and wisdom will proclaim, when I have gone, my praises and my fame. Now, the reign of Alexander in the Shahnameh, or Book of Kings, ushers in the quasi-historical section of the text. And again, like all the other sort of romances, it's almost completely sort of fantastical. Now, Alexander was Greek, so what is he doing in a Persian text? So one of the most important issues in all of these texts, in all these Alexander romances, were Alexander's birth and his origin, which were critical in appropriating the hero in various cultural areas. So if he, became sort of the hero of an Indonesian text, somehow he has to become relevant to Indonesia. So somehow he had to become relevant to Iran. So what does Ferdowsi do? According to the Shahnameh and Ferdowsi, Darius II defeats the Greek ruler Philip II, who was Alexander's, the Greek ruler. And when the two make peace, this is Alexander's grandpa, sorry, I'm getting confused myself, but Philip agrees the marriage of his daughter Nahi to the Persian monarch. So Philip II gives his daughter Nahi to Darius II. Now, Nahid goes to Iran, but after a while, Darius sends her back to Greece, to her father, because apparently she had bad breath. And he decided he had enough, and he wants, sends her back. Now, unbeknownst to him, Nahid was pregnant and gives birth to a son, whom she calls Iskandar in Greece, after the plant Alexandra, derived from the Greek scandis, garlic, which had cured her bad breath. So he tried to figure out this logic, but this is what the Persian sources mean. So at the same time, so when Nahi gives birth to Alexander in Greece, Darius II marries another woman, and she gives birth to a son who becomes Darius III. So unbeknownst to either of them, Alexander has a half-brother in Iran. Okay? When Philip dies, Alexander becomes king, and he decides to invade Iran. And here, the story is close to historical sources. Alexander fights the Iranian king 3 times, and the third time, Darius, the ruler, the Persian ruler, is stabbed by 2 of his ministers who were hoping to get a reward from Alexander. But Alexander, being just, he actually kills the 2 ministers who killed Darius, and finds out that Darius is dying out in the field, and goes to him. And in the meantime, he finds out that Darius is actually his half brother. So he cradles his head in his lap, And he says, I didn't realize you were my half-brother. Darius says, yes, I just found out you're my half-brother too. And will you do me a favor? Will you marry my daughter, Roxana? And will you take care of the Persian Empire? And of course, Alexander says, yes, of course I will. So this is the way that Alexander becomes a legitimate ruler of Iran. So he becomes inserted into Persian history. And I'm sure we all know it's not the first time that history has been rewritten for whatever reasons, but here we are. And this image of Alexander tending the dying Dara is one of the most popular images that you can find in the Book of Kings, for obvious reasons, because it's the key moment when Alexander sort of enters the narrative. Now, after Alexander makes these promises to his brother, he sets out to discover and conquer the rest of the world. Now, and Ferdowsi describes these encounters in some self-contained episodic fashion. Unlike other kings and heroes of the Shahnameh, who have to deal with the moral consequences of their actions, Alexander serves another key purpose in Ferdowsi's epic. He's constantly on the move, traveling by land and by sea to distant and unknown terrains. His marvelous adventures, however, are not aimless wanderings of a world conqueror, but the quest of a king for knowledge and wisdom. And it's one particular type of knowledge that Alexander was after. And that was the secret of immortality. This is again according to the Persian sources. Now, according to Ferdowsi, for 14 years, Alexander tested both physical and spiritual boundaries of the known and unknown worlds, a trait that sets him apart from the other characters in the Book of Kings. At the same time, the poet repeatedly underscores Alexander's vulnerability and the fact that despite all his power, wealth, and territorial conquest, he's still human and unable to escape death. Now, as a means to heighten the sense of drama, Alexander does not travel in a linear fashion, that would be far too boring. And he keeps going back and forth between China, which was the limit of the known world from the Persian perspective, and Andalusia in the west. So China in the east and Andalusia in the west. And what is interesting is that Andalusia was ruled by a woman, and you can, sorry, it's hard to see, but sitting right there with Alexander, and China, the figure on the throne, is ruled by a man, which is sort of interesting, this sort of balance between male and female in Ferdowsi. Now, even though Alexander becomes Persian, but Alexander remains Christian in this text. And you have to remember, this text was written in the year 1010, which is when Islam was ruling. I mean, Islam was the religion of the Greeks. What happens, Alexander goes also to Mecca and the Kaaba, which is sort of the black cube towards which Muslims turn for prayer. So he actually goes and visits Mecca and he visits the Kaaba, but he's not a Muslim, he's a Christian. And in many ways, by going to Mecca, that sort of really grounds the narrative in the Islamic world, even though he just keeps going back and forth, he's Christian, half-free, all of that. Now, the largest number of illustrations of the Alexander story appears in a really wonderful manuscript from the early 14th century. It was done around 1330 to 1336 in a city called Tabriz, which is in the northwest of Iran. It's called the Great Mongol Shrine. And if anybody is interested in seeing it, the Kafir and the Sakir actually have the largest number of folios from this manuscript because, like many manuscripts, it was taken apart in the early part of the 20th century. And not only that, yes, I agree. And if you see this, this actually shows Alexander and Sprout. I know it's hard to see, but it's not in the best of conditions. And the reason for that is that the owner of this manuscript in the early part of the 20th century realized that there were paintings on some of the folios, there were paintings on both sides, one on the back and the other one. And he realized that if he could get more money if he separated the two. So what he did, he spliced the pages, and it's like splicing a $1 bill. And as a result, you'll see a lot of these pages have been damaged, but it still remains one of the greatest manuscripts because not only is it quite large, but also because it really brings together both European influences and Chinese influences, and in many ways sort of a watershed in the history of the Persian painting. And I will show you other ones from this manuscript. Now, as we know, Alexander goes to India. And this is a painting from, again, from the great Mongol Shahnameh that shows Alexander in India battling the Four of India. Now, the Four was a ruler of India, and Alexander would, would invade a country, and if they sort of welcomed him, everything was fine. If they resisted him, there was battle. And this was the case of the Four of India. So the Four resisted Alexander, and the two decided to go to war. But Alexander had to come up with a way to fight the elephants that the Four of India had. So what he did, came up with an iron cavalry. There were metal horsemen filled with naphtha, and he set them aflame, which so frightened the Indians that they all fled in all directions. Now, again, this is, Alexander did go to India, but I don't think he came up with iron cavalry. So here you see the iron cavalry, and it's hard to see, and the Indians here are fleeing. And you can sort of see from this manuscript just sort of the dynamism. And the clouds are very much sort of in the Chinese manner, and this manuscript was greatly influenced by Chinese visual sources. I'm showing you a very different image of the same scene, much more static and much later than the 16th century, but it's clearer to see. So you see the iron cavalry here, sort of like the blowing fire, and the elephants are also bowing down because they just. So then Alexander, it's a very important scene. Sorry, it's hard to read. Now, what Alexander does, once he captures the Four, he places somebody else on the throne. And it's very interesting what he tells him. He tells him, and I quote from the Shahnameh, "Don't hide your gold away. Distribute and consume whatever comes to you, and put no faith in this passing world, who sometimes favors Iskandar, sometimes Four, and sometimes gives us pain and rage, sometimes joy and feasting." So as Alexander is sort of moving across the world, he's becoming more and more philosophical. This episode introduces Alexander's power and invincibility on the one hand, and life's transitory nature on the other. The conqueror may be advising the new ruler on the subject of fate and mortality, a central theme in the Shahnameh, but he's also secretly dreaming of defying death. And this is sort of captured in this painting, also from the great Mongol Shahnameh, where Alexander is going to see the Brahmins of India. Now again, this story is based in historical fact. Because according to the historical sources, when Alexander's army arrived in the Punjab in 326, the reconqueror allegedly became fascinated with the so-called naked philosophers. And here, this is a detail of the corner here. And you can see, but there are the Brahmins up there. According to Ferdowsi, Alexander questions the Brahmins or Indian holy men about their habits and way of life, and then engages them in philosophical exchange. When he asked them, who is the king of our souls, the response was need and greed. When he asked them what they wanted from him, they said, close the door of death and old age for us. Alexander responded, but there is no dealing with death. And the Brahmins responded, wise and powerful king, since you know that there is no resource against death, why do you long for the world in this way? Alexander finally agreed, and quote, no man can evade the will of God or explain what fate brings. He then offered the holy men many gifts, but they refused them all, as they had no need or greed. Even though Alexander agreed with the Brahmins, he did not give up the search for eternal life. He was quite arrogant. After fighting a monster or a rhinoceros in Ethiopia and a dragon at the end of the world, he travels west and hears about the land of darkness, the location of the source of the water of life. Again, this is from the great Mongol Shahnameh, and the other is from a mid-17th century text. You can sort of see that odd triangle. That is, again, a result of Mr. Demotte, who is the person responsible for cutting up the manuscript. Once he sort of realized that he made a mess of the manuscript, he started taking other pages and sort of making collages, and that's the result. So here is Alexander in the land of darkness. Here again, he meets, like the Brahmins, he meets the angel of death and asks him, the angel of death, about how to gain eternal life. Like the Brahmins, the celestial creature warns him about wandering in the world and reminds him that even he, with all his power and conquest, cannot escape death. Now, Alexander continues his journey, but he had two guides with him. And you can see the two guides here. The prophets, there are two prophets, Hiss and Elias, who actually do find the water of life. But the problem was Alexander loses them in the darkness. So while they find the water of life, he doesn't. And what is interesting is the way that they do find the water of life. The two prophets sit down, they're tired, and they find that they decide to have dinner. And they decide to cook a fish. And the fish accidentally, so they, you know, they prepare the fish. The fish accidentally falls into the water and suddenly, you know, becomes life again. So they realize that they have arrived at the end of life. And so they drink a bit, the horses drink a bit, and they come back and tell Alexander, but it was too late for Alexander. So again, he missed his chance. Now, Alexander considers his roamings. He arrives at the end of the world, where there are people called the God and Magog. And these are actually creatures who are also mentioned both in the Old Testament and in the Quran. And you can sort of see them up there. And Alexander, being just and sort of becoming wise through his travels, the people who live near the people of God and Magog ask him to protect them, and he builds a wall and a wall to protect the people from these wild creatures. And it's interesting. Recently, there have been excavations in Tajikistan, and they have found a wall that's been attributed to Alexander's time, and it may be sort of this wall. So again, this sort of very interesting over. exaggerated and elaborated. Now, oh, this is another scene of Alexander with the people of Gog and Magog. Here they're just giants that are supposed to be these horrible monsters. Now, one of the most sort of touching scenes towards the end of the Alexander cycle is Alexander's encounter with a talking tree. This tree has two trunks, one of which was female and the other male. During the day, the leaves of the male trunk warned him that he has wandered the world enough and that he's seen his share of blessings. At night, the sweet-smelling female trunks spoke to him and warned him against greed and arrogance. Of course, Alexander again asks, how can I gain immortality? And the tree says, there is no immortality for you, and you will in fact die very soon in a strange land without seeing your mother and any other relatives, which was a very cruel fate for an all-powerful sovereign like Alexander. And as and the prediction came through, Alexander died in Babylon, far away from his beloved mother and the rest of the family. Now, there's another image of the talking tree with these sort of wonderful animals in the branches, and Alexander sort of looking up beseechingly to see, you know, there is a answer to his question. Now, one of the greatest paintings in the great poem of Shahnameh is the death of Alexander. Now, according to Ferdowsi, Alexander knew he was dying, so he ordered his body to be soaked in honey and wrapped in the finest Chinese silk, and then his coffin was supposed to be made out of gold. His men, and these were orders that he had given, his men took his coffin from Babylon to Alexandria and placed it in an open air area for people to come and pray and show their last respects. Now, when you look at this painting, this is a very different interpretation of this scene. The coffin is placed in a sumptuous interior with gold lamps, candlesticks, and rich brocades and carpets that really in many ways embody sort of the material wealth that surrounded Alexander. And as both the Brahmins and the talking tree had predicted, there was no use for him. Brave, powerful, and wealthy, military invincible, Ferdowsi's Alexander is also ultimately human. Although he recognizes the truth in what the Brahmins, Israfil, and the talking tree tell him, and he even repeats it to others, Alexander is still yearning for physical immortality and is of course denied. Now this stands in sharp contrast to what Ferdowsi himself says at the end of his poem. Remember, he said that my work will make me immortal. So it's sort of this contrast between Alexander trying to get immortality through conquest and war, and Ferdowsi trying to, you know, gain immortality through his work. Now, Ferdowsi's adoption and transformation of the Macedonian Alexander from a conqueror to a sage in search of knowledge and in particular immortality continues in the text of another celebrated Persian poet, Nizami, who lived in the 12th century. And I just want to conclude with this. This is an image of Alexander from the work of Nizami. One of the long poems by Nizami is called Iskandarname, the Book of Iskandar. Although Nizami claims that the story of Alexander relies on Ferdowsi, it differs in at least two very fundamental ways. In the Shahnameh, Alexander is a Christian, even if he visits the Kaaba, but In this army, Alexander becomes a Muslim of Persian descent. According to this army, once Alexander has given Darius a royal burial and punishes his murderers, he also sets off on his travels and adventures. But instead of being driven by the quest of immortality, he traverses the known world, preaching about values and ethics. And the narrative of Nizami's later narrative acquires a more didactic and moral inflection. We have now come full circle from pre-Islamic Persian texts which condemned Alexander's action and compared him to the great villains of history. Now his travels and adventures are presented as a means to liberate the oppressed and fight injustice and spread wisdom. Now in the first section of his book of Alexander by Nizami, Alexander's journeys across various places, including the land of darkness. Here you have two images that deal with that. But here, the focus is not on Alexander's immortality again, but again on his material greed. And the angel keeps telling him, you know, don't look for so much, you know, wealth and territory. So focus on the on sort of your interior, sort of wealth and wisdom. And in this text, in Nizami's text, a big section really deals with Alexander's work. And Alexander announces that a man's status depends on his degree of learning, which encouraged the Greeks to compete for knowledge, and thus they became famous and immortal. So again, sort of knowledge making you immortal. And now in these particular texts of Nizami, illustrations show Alexander in discussion with philosophers such as Plato, Aristotle, and Socrates, or seeking the wisdom of a hermit in a cave who has abandoned all material means through prayer and self-discipline. And here it's hard to see, but he's sitting there in the center surrounded by the philosophers. And in this painting on the right, he's sitting and you sort of see the white beard of the hermit. In all of Persian literary tradition, Alexander is unique for undergoing such a dramatic transformation, which is masterfully captured in illustrated texts of the 14th to the 17th centuries. These works offer a unique glimpse into the medieval world, its ethos and complex relationship with the past. The exact reasons for Alexander's metamorphosis are not entirely clear, but it seems that the passage of time and the population's gradual conversion to Islam, his conquest of Iran and subjugation of Zoroastrianism became a distant memory. Ferdowsi transforms him into a legitimate king, both to preserve the integrity of Persian royal lineage prior to the arrival of Islam, and lays claim to his extraordinary achievements. Still focused on achieving immortality through conquest, Alexander serves as the perfect foil for Ferdowsi, who believes that immortality can only be secured through works like his great epic poem. By the 12th century, Alexander's pursuit of worldly power and immortality is replaced in his army by the quest for wisdom and the spread of justice in the novels. Nizami's Alexander knows he is mortal, but he also knows that he is a symbol of knowledge, understanding, rather than war, destruction, and conquest. Given the state of the world, it seems a good example to follow. Thank you.
A little bit about sort of modern Iranian attitudes towards Alexander, especially since I feel like within the Western context, he used to sort of the archetypal triumph of quest over peace.
Well, that's what's so fascinating. I mean, you know, throughout the ages, that Alexander is so important. I mean, for Iranians to this day. But it's also, you know, sort of changed. I mean, he's a very complex figure. I mean, if he weren't complex, you know, we wouldn't be talking about him. And also, I mean, we're not the only ones. I mean, you know, only I think it was a couple of weeks ago there was an article in the New Yorker about Alexander. I mean, it's constant sort of assessing his role. And in Iran, I mean, in a way, sort of Persepolis is sort of the greatest monument for Iran. And the fact that he destroyed it, I mean, eventually, I mean, you know, he wouldn't be able to stand anyway. I mean, but Alexander sort of willfully or unwillfully, you know, set fire. So that is something that I think is sort of stained the let's say, sort of the national sort of identity of Iranians. But at the same time, so you have Persepolis, and then you have the Shahnameh or the Book of Kings, which really embodies sort of Iranian identity at its sort of fullest. I mean, you grow up as a child, everybody knew stories from the Book of Kings. I mean, it's, you know, it's sort of wonderful because you have all these demons and sort of horrible, you know, kings with snakes growing from their shoulders. I mean, it's just great stories. So this is, you know, it's like the Grimm's fairy tales. This is what, I mean, I grew up with, and, you know, you're taught it at school. And Alexander is in that text, and the way that Ferdowsi has sort of changed Alexander's identity and really made him integral to this whole history of Iran is important, and Ferdowsi looms larger than life. So Alexander is accepted. I mean, he, like all the kings, and that's something that comes out in Ferdowsi, you know, everyone is flawed, every king is flawed. Now, Alexander's flaw was, you know, was a big flaw, but he also did some good things. So he's, you know, he's treated, you know, there is that the issue of Persepolis, but he's still, he's treated like as a Persian king.
So thanks so much for talking to us. You mentioned that in one of these stories he's portrayed as a Christian who goes to Mecca. What was really the purpose of this time travel, basically? What were they trying to accomplish with that?
Well, that's really, again, that's, I think it's sort of part of really integrating Alexander into this history. Because, I mean, it was a stretch to make him, you know, the half-brother or the king, etc. And by taking him to Mecca, you know, I mean, that Mecca was sort of the center, and is the conceptual religious center of Islamic world. So by taking him there, you know, he really becomes, again, part of this whole narrative of the Islamic world. And you know, it's interesting that he goes as a Christian. And we all know Christians can't go to Mecca. I mean, only Muslims can go to Mecca. But again, Alexander can do anything he wants. So he goes. But I think it's really to sort of bring it into the central narrative. And unfortunately, you know, we know very little about Ferdowsi. You know, he didn't leave anything behind except this, you know, this his work, that what he was thinking. But he, I think, he there must have been some sort of tension or something about why is Alexander playing such an important role in this epic? And I think he sort of uses everything to
make it, to legitimize this in this area. Thank you so much for coming in. This is sort of a follow-up on my question. I noticed that in one of the manuscript pages that you presented, Alexander is represented very much, it seems, akin to the Christ and Majesty sort of scene.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering what role appropriating such, it seems, Western religious iconography into
this. Which one?
It's really, it's the blue, it's one of the really blue background, it's damaged.
Oh, is it, maybe it's the first one there.
Yeah, he's enthroned.
Yeah.
It looks a lot like a Christ and Majesty scene. I was just wondering what that might iconography, like, what it took, was it being, would it appropriate itself consciously or would it just associate with his religion, if any at all, beyond his reference?
I'm sorry, I couldn't really go into the details of the paintings, but the importance of this manuscript is the fact that there's a lot of Western influence and also Chinese influence. And when you think Tabriz is sort of in northwestern Iran, it was right on the Silk Road, so and it was the capital at the time. So there were both sort of Western merchants, travelers coming through, and also from the east. And you get a great deal of, again, Western influences, probably manuscript, Byzantine, it's not so far. I mean, there are huge Christian communities in Iraq and Syria at the time, so you didn't have to necessarily go to Europe to get the manuscripts. So it was much closer at hand. And for instance, there's another scene of the Brahmins. I mean, that is right out of a medieval manuscript. Now, in some instances, I think the artist knew what they were copying. For instance, there is there's another manuscript that was done slightly later than the great Mongol Shahnameh that is a universal history of the Islamic world. And in that universal history, there's a scene of the birth of Muhammad, and it's based absolutely perfectly on the birth of Christ. So in that case, sort of medieval manuscript, I mean, the for instance, where the three wise men would have stood, they've changed them to three women. But, the composition is exactly the same. So I think in that case, they sort of knew what they were copying. In other instances, I think, you need a horseman, you take a horseman. So I think, we have so little information. But sometimes, in some instances, you can find the one and almost a one-to-one relationship between an image and a Persian manuscript and a Western manuscript. And other times, it's just the fact that there is spatial progression in this manuscript which didn't exist in Persian. So, yeah.
My question is about Ferdowsi's relationship to Alexander the Great, since he's working so hard to legitimize him within this tradition of storytelling in Persian literature. It seems odd to think that he's actually setting him up as a foil to arts over military conquest. I think it was mentioned in the lecture, but I'd be interested to hear more about that.
Well, actually, Ferdowsi is not the, I'm sort of lost over that, but he's not the first person legitimize Alexander. There are actually a number of Tabarizes. There are a number of the great historians who also do the same. And I think it's more of a sort of Islamic concept of taking and making him part of this whole history. When you look at Ferdowsi, and it's sort of unfair to just take Alexander, almost all of the characters in Ferdowsi are really complex, complicated characters, and that's why we love epics. I mean, I actually did a small show on the Shahnameh recently, and I compared it to Star Wars. Of course, everybody said I was out of date because. That sort of hadn't seen, a lot of people hadn't seen Star Wars, but that's what a great epic is. The characters are complicated. Alexander, for Ferdowsi, and again, to summarize it for tonight, he's complicated. He's not a sort of one-dimensional figure. And Ferdowsi sort of plays with his characters. I mean, there are others who sort of serve as foils. But Alexander seems so different from the other kings that Ferdowsi describes, in the way that his life is described, his activities. I mean, the way he just goes back and forth across the world with no moral consequences, other than he's got this one thing on his mind to get immortality. All the other rulers, whatever they do, they have to pay for the consequences for whatever they've done. So there is, I mean, and now this is, this is my opinion, but I think that Alexander is more complicated and plays a different role in Ferdowsi. And hopefully, we can talk more about it and figure it out, and sort of tease it out.
I was actually wondering if Ferdowsi was alive when the manuscripts were created and decorated, and if so, this really self-conscious exploration of what it means to be an artist is seen in the meaning of his images?
Unfortunately not. There are no Persian illustrated manuscripts prior to basically the 14th century, believe it or not. Even though there are objects with scenes, and again, the freer, I feel like I'm here just promoting the freer gallery, but I am, so you don't have to come and visit. There's a little beaker, it's only about this size, that has a whole story from the Shahnameh illustrated on it. And it's 100 years earlier than this manuscript. So we know that painting was done prior to the 14th century, quite remarkable, nothing has survived. And nobody really knows why. One explanation is the Mongol invasion. The Mongol invasion was this, cataclysmic event in the Near East, sort of the year 1250. And, there was some remarkable descriptions of, the destruction of Baghdad, for instance, had manuscripts and he was thrown into the river. So that's one of the reasons. So we don't really know what existed. So our earliest illustrated manuscripts are from the 14th century.